So it's sort of sad, but with great pleasure, that we arrived at the fifth and final lecture of our series. Anyone who was here on the first talk, Christine's going to top and tail this Art and War series. Christine talked about the Armada portrait of Elizabeth I in her first talk, and now she's fast-forwarding to the early 19th century, to the Napoleonic Wars and the Battle of Trafalgar. Christine, as I said before, is the chief curator at the National Gallery, but before that she was the head of arts and the curator of the Queen's House and curated the Royal Museum's Greenwich show, Turner and the Sea, which I would say this, wouldn't I? I thought it was one of the best Turner shows that I've ever seen. And in it, one of the stars was, of course, The Fighting Temeraire by Turner. So it's with great pleasure that I'm introducing Christine now to talk about Turner, Trafalgar and The Fighting Temeraire. Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. I did think it was time we got back to the Navy. We've had way too much army in between the Armada portrait and the Fighting Temeraire. So what I'm going to try and do during this talk is actually round off the series. So a number of things that were mentioned over the last couple of lectures I will mention again, just to show, I think what I'm trying to do is not only give you a sense of the context, the lead up to the Fighting Temeraire. I almost felt that perhaps everyone's memory should be wiped before they walked into the room in terms of the current fame and celebrity of Turner's, one of his most famous paintings, but actually think about Turner's choices that he made in 1839 when he exhibited the painting at the Royal Academy, the choices that he made at that point. So in some senses, I'm leading you up to the moment when Turner decides to create that particular work of art. We have got a lot of slides, and we're going to be bouncing around because this actually is quite a complex story, and some of these works of art actually have complex histories in terms of the locations that they were in, were commissioned for, were displayed in, and where they end up. But I think by the end of it, you'll get a very strong sense, I hope, of the importance of marine painting in the context of the Navy and the French and Napoleonic War period, but also a sense of the history and the legacy that someone like Turner is actually engaging with in order to create something like The Fighting Temeraire, and the surprise that I think a painting like that would have caused in 1839 in relation to the particular event of Trafalgar. So, towards the end of 1822, Turner was commissioned by George IV to paint the Battle of Trafalgar. Measuring 12 feet across, it would be his largest work of art and arguably his most complex and ambitious on the theme of war. Developed during the 16th century, by the end of the 18th century, battle painting was an established and distinct branch of marine art, and one that Turner encountered very early in his career. Indeed, Turner's first exhibited painting, Fisherman at Sea, was included in the Royal Academy of 1796, as was Nicholas Pocock's His Majesty's Ship, the Brunswick, engaging the Vengeur on the 1st of June, 1794. Pocock's painting represents the apogee of a distinctive British conception of marine painting that focused on the successive naval encounters of this period, that focused on the contemporary, the newsworthy, on accuracy, authenticity, distinct detailing of naval architecture and weather conditions. The Battle of the Glorious 1st of June was the first major fleet action of the French Revolutionary War, fought 400 miles off the coast of Brittany between the French and British fleets. Although both sides claimed victory, the five-day battle culminated in the sinking of the Vengeur de Peuple, translated as Avenger of the People, and the capture of six more French ships by the British under the command of Admiral Lord Howe. The ferocity of the battle and its heavy casualties were reported widely, and within weeks, numerous artists claimed to be in the process of creating works of art in response. Yet despite the prominence of such paintings and the much admired artistic tradition that they sought to emulate, even surpass, and despite that this extended period of conflict, as represented by the French Revolutionary Napoleonic Wars, that is from 1792 to 1815, I think you're getting fed up with Brexit after 3 years, my goodness. After that of a length that you really would be fed up, battle painting was to feature very little, actually, in Turner's work. In fact, he exhibited only three paintings of contemporary military events at the Royal Academy, British Institution, or his own gallery. Two naval subjects of the battles of the Nile, fought in 1798, and Trafalgar, fought 1805, and Waterloo, fought 1815. And in fact, his Battle of Waterloo is in fact the aftermath of the battle. All three of these paintings were speculative ventures, that is, not commissions, unlike his second Battle of Trafalgar. But if the depiction of actual battle scenes was of limited artistic interest, in contrast, Turner's engagement with Trafalgar in particular and the British Navy more generally was wide-ranging and profound. And it was a subject that he returned to repeatedly in exhibited paintings and watercolours and in designs for numerous print projects. And I'm showing you these two scenes post-Trafalgar, which show the naval ships, the ships of the line, the warships, here and here, guarding the coast. So the idea of post-Trafalgar as a moment when the Navy was victorious, prevented invasion, and therefore that people were allowed to go about their business in security. So this is the presence of the Navy post-Trafalgar. Above all, Turner's interest in the subject of Trafalgar is signposted by three major works that span more than 30 years. The Battle of Trafalgar as seen from the mizzen starboard shrouds of the Victory of 1806-8, the Battle of Trafalgar in 1823-4, and of course, the Fighting Temeraire tugged to her last berth to be broken up 1838, which was exhibited in 1839. And I sort of think of these things almost like a triptych, a religious triptych, although actually in reality it's more like that in terms of the actual scale. But that's the beauty of PowerPoint. You know, you can pretend that these things are exactly the same size. In analysing Turner's and his contemporaries' responses to Trafalgar, it is important to bear in mind the broader culture of British wartime and post-war patriotism and associated victory culture, including the visual arts, at a time when the Navy had achieved a unique position within British culture more widely. Late 18th and early 19th century naval patriotism was not simply a reflection of Britain's islandness and perennial fear of invasion from the sea, as represented by these two famous caricatures by Gilray. Late 18th and early 19th, or a consequence of naval success and the commemoration of its officer heroes past and present. And these are two of the most famous images of naval officers, of course, Captain Cook and Lord Nelson. But furthermore, as a hierarchical and relatively meritocratic community, that the Navy had become a potent metaphor for British society as a whole and a focus for debate around issues concerning the nation state and national identity. And in fact, we were talking last week about standing armies. In fact, the standing Navy was the first, hence the title of the Navy even to this day as the senior service. It was also one that professionalized earlier, that had regulation uniform earlier for officers and ranks and so on that actually established itself in the 18th century. But what I wanted to show you here was this idea of a community on board ship, no matter how fanciful or difficult that might be continually, but this notion of the community, especially post, of course, the Battle of the Nile and Nelson's famous description of his officers as band of brothers. And I wanted to show you this just from this engraving here, showing in the medallions portraits of the officers that fought with Nelson at the Battle of the Nile, and the medallion here, of course, of Nelson himself, and then the medallions that you actually see around the borders of the Armada tapestries, which, of course, survived and would certainly have been known. They only burned in 1834, and in 1739 there's a very famous folio of engravings by John Pine, of which this is one, which actually sort of lays out the entire campaign, including the officers, the ships, but also, importantly, the speech made by Elizabeth I at Tilbury. So the symbols of naval patriotism were the Navy's victories, its ships, its commanders, and its sailors, expressed in popular phrases such as heart of oak and wooden walls, which became common currency alongside the cultural stereotype of the honest, nautical, jargon-speaking sailor, Jack Tar. The ship of state, therefore, a universal metaphor, resonated powerfully in Britain, but it was not without its challenges. Indeed, the major challenge to this notion of a dutiful community of the Navy was actually strikingly challenged by the mutinies of Spithead and the Nore in the spring and early summer of 1797. Spithead itself was more of an industrial dispute, complaints about food and pay and conditions, whereas Nore had a clear political agenda. And indeed, the major, the ringleader of it, this person who was identified as such, was Richard Parker, who you see in this caricature on the right-hand side. And you'll also see him hanging from the yardarm here of HMS Sandwich, on which, of course, he was one of the sailors. Hence then, pre and post the Spithead and Nore mutinies, the resonance of representations that, of the Navy that foregrounded the success, discipline, courage and loyalty of officers and ratings alike. And the three battles we have here, associated of course with Nelson, is the Battle of Cape St. Vincent of February 1797 against Spain with Admiral Jarvis in command, the Battle of the Nile, fought in August 1798, or otherwise known as the Battle of Aboukir Bay, off the Nile Delta in Egypt. In command, of course, was Rear Admiral Nelson, his Vice Admiral during Trafalgar. And then the Battle of Copenhagen in April 1801, fought off the Bay of Copenhagen. That was Denmark and Norway versus the British Navy. However, of all naval engagements, it was the Battle of Trafalgar, fought on the 21st of October, 1805. Anyone that's worked at Greenwich has that tattooed on their chest, by the way. 21st of October, 1805, fought off Cape Trafalgar, a headland near Cadiz, which is not without your resonance in terms of the Navy and Francis Drake and so on the southern coast of Spain, against the combined French and Spanish fleets. And this battle, it is this battle that defined the relationship between the Navy and the nation for at least the next 100 years. So the Battle of Trafalgar began after Nelson caught sight of a Franco-Spanish force of 33 ships. Preparing to engage the enemy force, Nelson divided his 27 ships into two divisions and signaled the famous message from his flagship, Victory. England expects that every man will do his duty. In 5 hours of fighting, the British devastated the enemy fleet, destroying 19 of their ships. No British ships were lost, but 1,500 British sailors were either killed or wounded in heavy fighting. The battle raged at its fiercest around, perhaps unsurprisingly, Victory. And a French, as we would say, sniper on Redoutable, the French ship, shot Nelson in the shoulder and chest. So it went through his shoulder into his chest. As the French were preparing to board Victory, Temeraire, the second ship in the British windward column, approached from the starboard bow of Redoutable and fired on the exposed French crew with a cannonade, causing many casualties. In the meantime, Nelson was taken below deck and died at 4:30, about 3 hours after being hit, in enormous pain, it has to be said, and the battle itself ended some 30 minutes later. His last words, after being informed that the victory was imminent, victory, by the way, victory on board, victory, was imminent, were reported as, "Now I am satisfied. Thank God I have done my duty." So the importance of the event as a whole went well beyond strategic advantage. First, it was a decisive and strategic victory, yes, that underlined Britain's naval supremacy and signalled to the British public the end of Napoleon's invasion plans. Second, for the nature and the conduct of the battle itself, with its emphasis on total victory. Nelson very famously said that what the public wants is not mere victory, but annihilation. So that's what he went for, the Nelson touch, as it's called. And third, that the commander of the British fleet, Vice Admiral Nelson, had been killed. Thus, Trafalgar came to signify a uniquely powerful fusion of victory, violence, duty, and sacrifice, and one might even say the ultimate sacrifice. In order to galvanise support for the ongoing war, especially in the wake of Napoleon's victories at Austerlitz and Ulm in November and December of 1805, the British government sought to gain maximum political benefit from Trafalgar and Nelson's death in victory. After all, they'd been fighting for some 13 years, and they still had 10 years to go. The centrepiece of this strategy was Nelson's state funeral in January 1806, a carefully stage-managed event that was calculated to emphasise the Navy's centrality to the nation. And what you have on the screen here, of course, is the beginning of the procession. Nelson lies in state in the painted hall of Greenwich Hospital and travels by the Thames, and just remembering where the Temeraire travels en route to Rotherhithe, then goes down the river, comes, I think it's Whitehall, then there's a procession by street to St. Paul's Cathedral. And I'm rather struck, actually, in terms of the location, and sometimes it's location, 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 and actually you'll hear this actually in this lecture, that the Greenwich Hospital was designed by Christopher Wren. It had a major naval, you know, victorious scene in the painted gallery, painted by James Thornhill. That's where Nelson lies in state, in the centre there. And then St. Paul's Cathedral, designed by Christopher Wren, with paintings by James Thornhill on the subject of St. Paul. And it's below the dome itself that actually Nelson is buried. So as a focus of national celebration and mourning, the Battle of Trafalgar also proved to be the single most important event of the war for the British art world, primarily because of the potential it offered artists for public display and promotion, whether through independent and speculative projects as part of the regular exhibition culture, through prints and illustrated publications, or via competitions and public subscriptions for projects of national, regional, and colonial commemoration. Over and above the benefits it could offer individual artists, the Royal Academy of Arts, a highly status-conscious institution, took the opportunity to assert itself as an arbiter of taste, state culture during the war period. This strategy became more evident as the debate around public and official commemoration intensified after 1805. For example, the Academy and the government-appointed Committee of Taste, populated largely by directors of the British Institution, were asked to deliberate over the location and design of Nelson's monument in St. Paul's Cathedral. And what's really interesting about the development of the crypt of St. Paul's is that you don't just get people like Nelson and Wellington, but of course this is where Turner and Lawrence and the Royal Academicians are buried. And so what I think is interesting about the Band of Brothers is the idea of the brothers in art, or brothers of art, that there's a phrase that Turner used, is this idea of the Navy as a meritocratic community of brothers, and the same is true of the Royal Academy. So I think on some level there's a kind of synergy between these two institutions. Now, I said earlier on that actually Turner engaged with Trafalgar continually and across his entire career, and this is a case in point. On some level, this is purely a perspective view of London, absolute classic view from Greenwich looking towards London itself. But let's remember that this is Greenwich Hospital, where the naval pensioners are. This is where Nelson lay in state. And then you have the winding river going towards, in the distance, St. Paul's Cathedral. So to me, this is also, in some senses, a Trafalgar painting, because it's underlined the two key locations that are associated not just with Trafalgar, but of course, Nelson himself. However, state funding of the arts, meagre in comparison to that of France, at this time was directed exclusively towards sculptural and architectural commemorative projects. Consequently, those painters who responded to the immediate aftermath of the battle did so from private commissions and competitions or via public exhibition. It was under these circumstances that Turner produced his first Battle of Trafalgar within months of Nelson's funeral. The painting was subsequently reworked by Turner and exhibited again at the British Institution in 1808. Turner's opportunism was by no means unique, and we saw this last week in Mark's lecture. The president of the Royal Academy, Benjamin West, exhibited his Death of Nelson in his own gallery in 1806 before exhibiting the same work at the Royal Academy in 1811 alongside its engraved version by James Heath. Such entrepreneurial and market-led strategies have been a feature of the British art scene since the 1760s, following the inauguration of public exhibition of contemporary art in London at the Society of Artists from 1761 and the Royal Academy from 1769. However, the extended war period offered a far greater concentration of topical subjects for artists, particularly after the Battle of the Nile in 1798, which established Nelson as the most successful and celebrated admiral in the British naval history. Turner's first battle painting and the first of his paintings representing contemporary events was the Battle of the Nile, exhibited at the RA in 1799. Its current location is unknown. Anyone that's going around their attic or something like that and finds a Turner, let's hope it's the Battle of the Nile. Now, this Battle of the Nile was one of five on the same subject in the same exhibition that year, alongside two by Nicholas Pocock and two by Robert Cleveley. As stated in the exhibition title for his Nile painting, Turner, and it was a very long one, by the way, and Turner does long titles, as we said. That's normal in marine painting. They often explain exactly what you're looking at, the battle itself, the moment of the battle, who's there, the date. That's quite standard with marine painting. It's something that sort of Turner carries on into exhibiting. As stated in the exhibition title for his Nile painting, Turner focused on the dramatic explosion of the massive French flagship Lorient, or the Orient, during the battle. We might therefore assume that his composition found some parallels with Philip James de Lutherburgh's painting of the same subject, exhibited at the Royal Academy in 1800. For his next exhibited battle painting, Turner went beyond the conventions of battle imagery to engage with late Georgian representations of the heroic death tableau. The dying martial hero as a kind of secular martyr was heralded by West's Death of General Wolfe, exhibited at the Royal Academy in 1770, and Mark was talking about this painting last week. This was an image that Nelson seems to have been familiar with, and, as West was later to claim, the Admiral even expressed a hope that the artist would create his own version should Nelson die in battle. In 1808, and this also links into this idea that Nelson committed suicide, but I can, it's not, that's rubbish. He didn't. By being on the deck of the ship. I mean, where else is a commander going to be on a ship than on the decks? I mean, it seems a bit odd to think that he'd be below deck in for any great length of time. So anyway, I think that's broadly been discounted. In 1806, Benjamin West duly obliged with his Death of Nelson. The engraved version of which he promoted as a pair to the financially successful Wolfe print. West had elevated the subject of General Wolfe's death first by taking liberties with the historical facts and second by utilising compositional devices from Christian iconography associated with the Passion, above all when Jesus' lifeless body is lowered from the cross into the arms of his mourners. And what you see here lower right is Rubens' famous Descent from the Cross in Antwerp Cathedral. I think it was painted in 1616, 1617. The approach was acceptable to artists because of the established conventions of history painting, widely held to be the most formally and intellectually challenging of all genres. John Singleton Copley and others developed West's highly successful, if inherently fictionalized, form of his heroic representation still further in the 1780s and 1790s, to the extent that by 1805 there existed a ready formula within British visual culture for representing Nelson's death. Arthur William Deavis brought the quasi-religious death tableau to an extraordinary climax in his sacral Death of Nelson of 1807. And we'll come back to this image in a moment. So utilising these diverse pictorial modes in his first Battle of Trafalgar, Turner incorporated West's focus on the figure of the dying admiral, surrounded by officers, sailors and marines, within a broader, more panoramic view of the action, to create a novel pictorial middle ground between the intimacy of the death tableau of contemporary history painting and the more distant viewpoint conventional with battle painting, as practised by Nicholas Pocock and others. So if you like, Turner's first Battle of Trafalgar, if Nicholas Pocock and Benjamin West had a love child, it would be Turner's first Battle of Trafalgar. And this melding that Turner achieved was actually because he adopted an unusual viewpoint looking down from the mizzen. Now, anyone that knows their naval architecture, a mizzen is the aftmost mast on a ship. Of, you know, if you've got more than one mast, the mizzen is the one, let's say, at the back. Nearest the stern. So you have four main mizzen on a three-masted ship, like Victory, for example. So you've got this viewpoint down from the mizzen of the Victory towards the decks of four ships of the line. The British Victory, of course, Temeraire and Neptune, and the French Redoutable, locked in close combat. The importance of such a view in shaping an audience's vicarious experience of war at sea, which of course most people would not have experienced, is underlined by the very precise title that Turner gave to the painting. So in other words, you're meant to be thinking you're sort of in the scene, as it were, in the action, and you know exactly what you're looking at. However, it must be said that the idea of people actually really grasping what it must have been like to be in a major fleet action, which actually weren't that common, because after all, you know, you want to... You know, if you lose half your ships, then it takes a very long time to build them, is that actually major fleet actions are really rather distant, I think, for most people to comprehend. I think most people would have understood what it must be like if they saw the fleet off the south coast of England, for example, at the various anchorages that you get. And most fleet actions, of course, are fought hundreds of miles from home. The immediate impact of Turner's first Battle of Trafalgar is not known, owing to the lack of published critical responses. However, the novelty of his approach was discussed at length in the Review of Art of 1808 by the engraver John Landseer, who characterised the painting as, quote, new in its kind, a British epic picture. Drawing parallels with Homer epic poetry, standard source material for traditional history painting, Landseer noted that Turner had detailed the death of the individual hero, Nelson, and suggested, quote, the whole of a great naval victory in a single picture. When he returned to the subject of Trafalgar in 1822, almost two decades after the event, Turner would again devise a British epic picture, but to very different effect and under very different circumstances. Britain was no longer at war, the French army having been defeated finally at the Battle of Waterloo in 1815, and Napoleon himself had died on St. Helena in 1821. In the years after Waterloo, the government continued to debate how best to commemorate the wars, the army and the navy, and their respective heroes. But the emphasis had changed since the initial response to Nelson's victory in 1805. Events had indeed proven that Trafalgar was a decisive naval battle, and could therefore be perceived, to quote Lord Castlereagh during a debate in the House of Lords in 1816, could be viewed as the grand point of consummation, as he called it, for the Navy's involvement during the entire war. Accordingly, any national monument to Trafalgar would have to encapsulate this sense of grandeur by commemorating, to use Castlereagh's words, the fame of Viscount Nelson and other officers, seamen and marines who died gloriously for their country's cause. In other words, the emphasis seems to have shifted away from Nelson's death towards the sacrifice that was made by everybody involved. Much more inclusive. Beyond the deliberations of Parliament, West's successor as president of the Royal Academy, Thomas Lawrence, was engaged in a number of prestigious war-related projects under the patronage of the Prince Regent, who from 1820, of course, was George IV, above all the Waterloo Chamber at Windsor Castle. In addition, the idea of a National Gallery of Naval Art at Greenwich Hospital, first mooted in the 1790s, had gathered momentum under the hospital's secretary, Edward Hawke Locker. And George IV gave his royal approval to the project by eventually donating 38 paintings from the royal collection by 1829. These included Turner's Second Battle of Trafalgar and its earlier pendant or pair, de Lutherburg's Glorious 1st of June, which were the last two sent to Greenwich from the Royal Collection in 1829. And this, these show you some views of the Painted Hall as it was decked out, as it were, with eventually some 300 paintings and a much smaller amount of sculpture. Here you have Chelsea pensioners and Greenwich pensioners actually talking about Turner's Battle of Trafalgar, which actually was in the vestibule of the Painted Hall. But later, when you see this sort of, you know, with the culmination of the scheme itself, with these full lengths of officers and then the fleet actions and half lengths and so on, that literally took you from the Armada to the Battle of Trafalgar. So it gave you this kind of run of magisterial history of the Navy and art through portraiture, battle scenes and so on. Is that actually you'll see here in the middle of the lower hall, actually Turner's Battle of Trafalgar with the de Lutherburg of the Glorious 1st of June on the other side. So that's the configuration that happens subsequently. So, sorry, I'm just showing you the larger version, so you can, we'll compare and contrast the paintings in a moment. In this context, it is highly significant that Lawrence promoted Turner, a fellow academician, to George IV for the Royal Commission of this Trafalgar painting, originally intended for a new scheme at St. James's Palace, and that another academician, George Jones, and Lawrence himself provided the other paintings. Such a move was surely calculated to foreground the Royal Academy and its members. Indeed, the scheme formed part of the King's wider ambitions at St. James's, Windsor, Buckingham Palace, and the Palace of Westminster to use the visual arts and architecture, with past and present academicians playing an integral role, as a means of presenting himself as the focus of national celebration, dynastic stability, and state culture. So what you have here is actually most of the scheme is still in place, except for the two paintings by Turner and de Lutherburg. Here you have George Jones's Victoria. This is Waterloo. This is the portrait and coronation robes of George IV. And Lawrence also provided a full length of George III, the father, of course, of George IV. And I just wanted to show you the Palace of Westminster. The Scala Regia, or Royal Stair and Royal Gallery scheme by Sir John Soane. These two drawings actually now at the Sir John Soane Museum, showing the vestibule of the Scala Regia. And this is the Royal Gallery. I don't think actually completed as is, maybe not with the battle scenes, but you can see clearly here possibly a Trafalgar and a Waterloo representation, which actually comes into play with the rebuilding of the new Palace of Westminster after the fire of 1834. This is the Royal Gallery here, with, let's see, on the left, of course, is Wellington meeting Blücher at the Battle of Waterloo, and the death of Nelson on the other side. So, so right at the heart of Parliament is representations of Trafalgar and Waterloo. And we should remind ourselves, of course, until 1834 and the fire in the House of Lords debating chamber, no matter where it was, I think this might even have been a temporary location, you have the Armada tapestries. So at the end of that run of battle scenes as intended was the battle of, you know, the Armada campaign. The St. James's Commission set out a number of important parameters and constraints for Turner, posed by the proposed location of the work within the state apartments of a royal palace, that is, away from public view, and the pairing with an existing work of art within a highly didactic scheme that, through representations of George III and George IV and the Battle of the Glorious 1st of June, Trafalgar, Victoria and Waterloo, placed the two most recent Hanoverian heads of state full square with Britain's naval and military success. Over and above its enormous size, de Lutherburg's painting is characterised by a number of compositional devices that are also notable in his other naval battle paintings. The ships of the line dominating the upper half of the composition, and in the lower half, the officers directing sailors who are saving fellow and enemy lives. Turner's composition broadly follows this format, however the two paintings are markedly different. Whereas de Lutherburg's composition encapsulates the kind of spectacular battle painting he had helped to popularise in the 1790s by emphasising the movement and dramatic confrontation between two colossal ships, Turner has a central static emphasis dominated by Nelson's flagship Victory, almost to the exclusion of any other ship, with a complex grouping of British sailors in and around small craft positioned directly below. Hence, the central dynamic of Turner's painting is that between the ship and the crew. That this was deliberate is suggested by the marked transition between the two preparatory oil sketches at the bottom of the screen that Turner produced in 1823, and these are both in the Tate's collection. From the first on the left, a more conventional image of fleet action, focusing on the relative positions of the ships of the line, to the second that more closely anticipates the finished painting. At first glance, Nelson is notable by his absence. In reality, he pervades the canvas, not only by association through the focus on his flagship and the various detail Turner incorporates, such as Nelson's famous signal, which of course is right here, and then of course his famous motto, let him who has earned it bear the palm. And it's actually, you can see it just below the waterline here. Some people actually think that this falling mast is meant to represent Nelson falling on the upper deck of Victory, but I mean, it might indicate the idea of the fallen hero, as it were, through the mast. But I think Nelson is also, of course, represented through the representation of the battle itself, certainly by 1822. I don't think anyone would divorce Trafalgar from Nelson. And thus Nelson himself presides over a scene of annihilation and euphoria. In the background of the painting, as masts shatter and collapse and clouds of smoke and fire obscure the ships, men of all nationalities are seen falling from the rigging or clinging to wreckage. On one level then, what Turner emphasizes via this modern-day apocalypse, or gory Trafalgar, as the artist himself described it, is the human cost of the battle, the inevitable outcome of the so-called Nelson touch. Given the almost ethereal presence of Victory presented floating high in the water, Turner might have been evoking Byron's description of Nelson in 1819 as Britannia's god of war. But I think it is a very patriotic painting, not least, of course, this emphasis on the Union flag literally being held up by a sailor. So it's sort of like this emphasis on the nation being held up by the Navy. The original setting for Turner's Second Battle of Trafalgar was the rarefied and exclusive domain of a cultured monarch with a specific post-war agenda. Within such an environment, Turner might have expected his highly poetic treatment of Trafalgar to be understood. However, the dominant art historical narrative associated with this painting is that from the time that it was installed in St. James's Palace, naval officers, seamen, naval historians were all united in their disapproval of it, largely on account of its apparent lack of historical accuracy. The discontented, so the story goes, range from the king's brother, the Duke of Clarence, the future William IV, the so-called Sailor King, who had served as a naval officer with Nelson and later became Lord High Admiral, to officer veterans of Trafalgar and, after its inclusion in the Naval Gallery, the Greenwich pensioners, themselves ordinary seamen, of course, many of whom had served under Nelson at the battle. Would Turner have created the same representation had he known that Greenwich Hospital was where it was destined to hang? It is perfectly possible that Turner would have welcomed the engagement with his painting of such a broad-based naval and public audience there, because, of course, you could pay to go into the painted hall, and, in fact, you'd be taken around by the Greenwich pensioners. He would, for example, have been aware of the much-reported loyalty of Victory's crew towards Nelson, their unprecedented and prominent participation in Nelson's funeral procession, and the controversy surrounding Nelson's funerary monument in 1806, which, with its 2p entrance charge to St Paul's Cathedral, excluded many ordinary sailors for whom the site had personal and professional meaning. I should just point out that Nelson was going to return from his body, was going to return from the Battle of Trafalgar, not on victory, but the victory's crew insisted on taking him home, and that's what the caricature on the left-hand side emphasises. And then the one on the right-hand side talks about the fact that the sailor can't get into St Paul's because he hasn't got 2p, so he makes his own monument to Nelson. Furthermore, in 1811, Turner had bemoaned the lack of a truly public, i.e. freely accessible, monument to Nelson and Trafalgar. Later, he even acknowledged how such a monument could function as a focus for commemoration among the naval community in his watercolour design of Great Yarmouth. Here, Turner shows ordinary sailors reenacting a battle, it's not Trafalgar, by the way, a battle with model ships in front of Nelson Monument, that had been erected by public subscription by 1819. And I think I'm right in saying that the first keeper of the monument was, in fact, a veteran of Trafalgar. And if anyone wants to know what ships of the line means, line was the main battle formation during this period, and it actually shows you very neatly what we mean. Ships of the line, or battleships, warships, would line up like this. See, normally in parallel formations, the enemy against each other, and you pound each other to death with broadside. But in fact, what Nelson did, the Nelson touch, he wasn't the first to do it, I don't think, but certainly was the one most identified, and this happened during the Battle of Trafalgar itself, is that actually the two parallel columns made out of the 27 warships on the British side actually intersected the French and Spanish ships at right angles. Now, the thing there, of course, the most vulnerable area of a ship is the prow and the stern, because there aren't many guns, and certainly not any cannon. The cannons are on, you know, either side of the ship. So once you cut across the line and then start firing, then you're literally annihilating anyone either side. And that in some essence, I mean, it's sort of a distillation of really what the purpose was of that cutting across the line of the ships, as opposed to parallel lines and pounding at each other. So it's quite a distinctive way of, certainly, well, very effective during the Battle of Trafalgar, but of course it meant that you were very vulnerable if you were on the deck. And indeed, that was the case with, of course, with Nelson. In 1826, the naval historian William James critiqued Turner's Trafalgar at some length. Acknowledging him to be the first marine painter of the day, James nonetheless noted that Turner's splendid picture displayed scarcely a line of truth. He continues, and I quote, "The principal reason urged for giving to this costly and highly honoured performance so preposterous a character is that an adherence to truth would have destroyed the pictorial effect." James concluded that it was a national disgrace that there existed, in 1826, no appropriate representation of Trafalgar, in his estimation at least. Nearly 10 years later, Clarkson Stanfield, who had previously served in the Merchant and Royal Navy, so therefore assuming he knew what he was doing, was commissioned by the United Service Club to paint an enormous Battle of Trafalgar as a pendant to yet another Battle of Waterloo by George Jones. The club was created in 1815 for high-ranking officers of the Army and Navy. The tradition surrounding the commission of Stansfield painting is that the officers who subscribed to it oversaw its progress, which included those who fought at Trafalgar. We might therefore assume that the result met their demands for technical and historical accuracy and, by being endorsed by serving officers and veterans, represented the kind of battle painting that William James had been calling for. Could Stanfield's painting have stirred Turner's competitive spirit once again, resulting, at least in part, in his last and most celebrated Trafalgar painting, The Fighting Temeraire? After all, Stanfield had emerged as one of Turner's artistic rivals in the 1820s, and his Trafalgar painting was not only exhibited at the Royal Academy in 1836, and the Royal Academy then was in Somerset House, but also from then onwards on permanent display in the club's new premises at 116 Pall Mall, now the Institute of Directors. And indeed, the painting is still there with the Battle of Waterloo. And this is literally just down from, as you know, Trafalgar Square. This was very near to the new building occupied by both the National Gallery and the relocated Royal Academy from 1838 at the north side of what would soon become Trafalgar Square. And what I'm showing you here is William Wilkins, the Wilkins building that we call in the National Gallery now. This is the layout, and anything in pink is, no, it's not the British Empire. It is, this is where the Royal Academy actually had their rooms. This is where they exhibited, and on the left-hand side is where the National Gallery's collection was exhibited. So they're actually in the same building. So again, going back to location, location, location. By 1843, the now iconic Nelson's Column designed by William Railton would be erected as its centrepiece, the long-awaited culmination of decades of debate over how to commemorate the British Navy and its celebrated hero. So this I found online. I don't know what date it is, but it must be about 1840 because the ground is laid out for Trafalgar Square, and this is the Wilkins Building over here, the National Gallery. You've got Le Sœur sculpture, of course, of Charles I, and then St. Martin in the Fields over here. But it's absolutely, when you look at it, it's absolutely flat. So I think it was just prior to the construction that occurs. This is about 1910. This is the Charles Barry oversaw the layout of Trafalgar Square and indeed designed these fountains, which were then changed later on by Lutyens, actually, in the first part of the 20th century. But here you see, of course, Nelson's Column, the Wilkins Building, and so on. And this is actually, this is fun, this is actually by Fox Talbot, showing the construction of the pediment with St. Martin and the Fields in the background. And on the pediment itself, as you see, are these four bas-reliefs of, guess what, St. Vincent, Nile, Copenhagen, and Trafalgar. And this, of course, is the death tableau much later in the period, 1849, by Carew. So it was at this auspicious moment that Turner caused a sensation at the Royal Academy in 1839 with his Fighting Temeraire. The immediate inspiration for this painting was, of course, the towing of Temeraire, the second-rate ship of the line that had played a central role at Trafalgar, to a shipbreaker's yard in Rotherhithe in 1838. After the Napoleonic War, many of the great warships were moored permanently off naval dockyards. From 1820, the Temeraire functioned primarily as a depot ship off Sheerness until sold at a routine Navy Board auction in August 1838 to the Rotherhithe shipbreaker and timber merchant. By this date, 14 of the 27 ships in Nelson's Trafalgar fleet had been sold off. Prior to sale, Temeraire had been stripped of anything useful to the Navy, including the mast, although there's some suggestion that perhaps the masts were in place, but I don't know that that's true. And in this state was towed by two steam tugs up the Thames late in September at high tide. You had to have a high tide because it's such an enormous object. In fact, at that point, I think it was the biggest object that had ever been that far up the Thames. Some newspaper reports noted that the ship's arrival in Rotherhithe had attracted public interest primarily because of its distinguished role at, quote, the memorable Battle of Trafalgar, and this was in the Times on the 12th of October, 1838. Masted and partially rigged, Turner's representation of Temeraire does not follow the facts, and that is true of other details in the painting. For example, the much commented detail that the sun sets in the wrong place, and also attempts to work out where on the Thames the scene is set. Personally, I'm not sure it's that relevant because I think this is a symbolic painting, but I can go into what I think about that. But also, Turner might not even have been there or even seen the Temeraire go up the Thames, but this didn't stop Mike Lee from reenacting this wonderful moment with Clarkson Stanfield, by the way, with Turner in the boat watching the Temeraire come up the Thames. I must admit, I actually found that really rather moving to see that actually enacted. This is sort of a gift, I think, that had never been, I don't think, done before. Given the critical acclaim it received at the Royal Academy, that there's the Fighting Temeraire, these liberties either went unnoticed or were deemed irrelevant in comparison to the painting's symbolic meaning. The Morning Chronicle noted, for example, quote, in his striking performance, Mr. Turner has indulged his love of strong and powerfully contrasted colours with great taste and propriety. A gorgeous horizon poetically intimates that the sun of the Temeraire is setting in glory. The drama of the composition hinges on such contrasts, such as the hot colours of the sky and water on the right, with the cool shades of the moon's reflection shimmering on the left, and the large ghostly ship pulled by a small black tug. Indeed, this complex image can accommodate countless interpretations, such as the passing of the age of sail to that of steam, or more broadly, death and regeneration. At the time, Turner was perhaps focusing above all on the expendability of this famous warship and the resonance of its fate in terms of British naval and maritime power. The painting was accompanied in the exhibition pamphlet with the lines, and I quote, "The flag which braved the battle and the breeze no longer owns her." The words were adapted from a well-known patriotic poem, Ye Mariners of England, a Naval Ode, by Thomas Campbell. And Turner's other exhibits in 1839 included the subjects of ancient and modern Rome and the ill-fated Roman statesman Cicero. Indeed, in response to Turner's Modern Rome Campo Vaccino, a review in the Art Union was struck by its representation of imperial decline. Quote, "The glory has parted, the eternal city with its splendours, its stupendous temples and its great men all have become a mockery and a scorn. The plough has gone over its grandeur." And this isn't the first time, of course, that Turner engages with the idea of rise and fall of empires, and often actually compared and contrasted industrial maritime Britain with, for example, the decline of the other maritime power, Venice. As previously noted, many other ships had suffered a similar fate to the Temeraire. Even so, the subject of Trafalgar had undoubtedly been re-energised by the preparation and laying out of the square from the late 1830s. Given my previous comments concerning symbols of naval patriotism, what Turner delivered in 1839 was not simply a coup de théâtre. This is evident from the comments above all the allusions made in other responses to the painting, the critical responses. And I think this is the clue to the power, I think, of a contemporary audience for this particular painting. For the critic in the Literary Gazette, that the painting went beyond literal representation was pretty self-evident. Quote, "treated as it is historically and allegorically. Given the by now standard associations of Trafalgar with ultimate sacrifice, the anthropomorphic analogies made by a number of writers in response to the Fighting Temeraire are of particular significance. And I quote, "there is something in the contemplation of such a scene," noted the critic of the Morning Chronicle, "which affects us almost as deeply as the decay of a noble human being. It is impossible to gaze at the remains of this magnificent and venerable vessel without recollecting, to use the words of Thomas Campbell, how much she has done and how much she has suffered for her country." And I'm juxtaposing this with the earlier death of Nelson, because I wonder if the juxtaposition of white and black might in some senses have influenced Turner, and he would have known this painting very well. The critic in The Spectator even described the ship and tugboat as, and I quote, "like a superannuated veteran led by a sprightly boy," and concluded appropriately enough, and when I was at Greenwich, I thought this was a very good idea, that this painting ought to be purchased for Greenwich. Now I'm at the National Gallery, of course, that's a terrible idea. So, but here I'm juxtaposing, Mark last week actually talked about the Chelsea Pensioners, which was commissioned by the Duke of Wellington, but later on he does commission a Trafalgar version that you can see here by John Burnett. So I think the point I'm trying to make, I mean, not only did the Temeraire pass Greenwich Hospital, and the veterans and the wounded and the decayed bodies that actually are represented there through the people that survived the Battle of Trafalgar, but also just underlined, you know, the way that people reacted to the painting, that actually see it in human terms rather than just an inert, inanimate ship. In the event, both the Fighting Temeraire and Turner's first Battle of Trafalgar form part of Turner's bequest to the nation after his death in 1851. By mid-century, therefore, all three Trafalgar paintings by Turner were in the public domain. However, it was not Turner, necessarily, but Stanfield who would have the final word on Trafalgar in this sequence of artistic responses. In 1844, Stanfield had become the first curator of paintings at Greenwich Hospital. Indeed, it was him that rearranged them so that Turner's big painting went in from the vestibule to the centre stage, essentially, in the lower hall. They were friends, by the way, and Stanfield greatly admired Turner. And in 1853, 2 years after Turner's death, Stanfield exhibited HMS Victory towed into Gibraltar at the Royal Academy. While acknowledging that Turner's Temeraire and Stanfield's Victory are very different images, it is important to note, perhaps primarily to note, that Stanfield chose to choose at this time on the motif of the ship being towed. In this sense, Stanfield's painting not only participated in the ongoing engagement by British artists with the battle and its significance, but also a timely tribute to Turner himself. Thank you.